pajamas? That's right, the Wisemans were quarantined this week, but we still have a super special big house just for you. Be sure to check it out. Also, parents, kids, we have revamped our daily devotions this week and for the entire month. The month of July is for Jesus, the book of John, and we have a special assignment every single day. Be sure to check them out and send me photos of you doing the assignments. Go to Christ United Kids YouTube channel, click subscribe, and turn on your notifications so you do not miss anything. And don't forget to check out Big House.
Welcome, Christ United. We are so glad to have you joining our service here today. Hey, I'm not sure if I'm going to use my Jeff hands or if I'm going to use my Steve hands. So whatever I do with my hands, just bear with me. All right. Hey, we are so glad to have you folks with us today. Be sure to like us on Facebook, which is Christ United MB. You can always hop on over to Instagram and follow us there. Or feel free to jump on YouTube, click the subscribe button, and then hit the bell in the top corner. And that way you'll be sure to get all the notifications. Or you can go to all three social media outlets and like us there. Hey, don't forget to stay connected. Prayer calls are every day at 5, 6, 7, and 8 o'clock in the morning. So if you're not an early morning person, feel free to pick a different time. Hey, we are staying connected with each and every one of you. Be sure to join us. Every Wednesday, we've got Discipleship Live. This is a lot of fun. If you want to jump on Zoom, you can do it that way, and that way you can give a lot of feedback and see people's faces and they can see yours. If you're not into that, you can go on Facebook Live and you can watch it there as well and feel free to comment. Hey, this is my favorite part, which is giving. I absolutely love giving. And here at Christ United, we invite you to do so. So in the description of the video, you're going to see a link that'll take you right there and you can give as an act of worship. Also, check this out. July 12th, starting at 10 a.m., we're going to be at the Blessed Barn in Ainer, y'all. I'm not sure how to get there, but I think it's this way. Make a left and go right, and then good luck. That's all I can tell you. Hey, seriously, though, go on thechristislove.org, and you can register there on the website to join us on July 12th at 10 a.m. It's going to be great to have you out there. Christ United, we love you. Enjoy today's service.
Darkness run for cover, but the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. Yeah, I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. Oh, my praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Washed in water, sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Yes, our God will finish what He started. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. Yeah. This is my testimony. This is my testimony.
Hey. Oh, this is my testimony. Yeah. I'm not dead, you're not done. Yes, God. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Oh, yes. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Yeah. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Rewrote my story. I'll testify.
Yes, Lord,
by Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. Oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony.
Yes, it is. It's my testimony. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yeah.
God, we honor you.
Sing a little louder.
Oh, sing a little louder.
Before there were cell phones, or go even farther back, before there were internet or even television for that matter, where the only way, the only main source of any kind of news getting around was, you know, either a letter or it was word of mouth. And whenever you hear rumors of a distant country, yeah, sure, sounds good, but you probably don't really believe it. But whenever you hear the same kind of stories coming from this distant country over and over and over again, all from different people, you start to think to yourself, you know, if I ever get a chance, I'm going to go there. I'm going to check it out. You see, in Rome, Caesar Augustus had just introduced free bread and free entertainment. It was Rome's way of kind of keeping people busy and happy. If people were bored, they may make fun of the emperor, criticize him, and you can't have that. So in Rome, there was free bread to be had. In Rome, you could go to the Colosseum and just have 50,000 seats, and you could go and see gladiator versus gladiator, free versus slave, men versus wild animal. There's rumors that, you know, they're going to flood the bottom of the Colosseum. Boat races and fights will take place. It was violence like crazy. If you ever get tired of the Colosseum, go down to the Hippodrome, 250,000 seats. You know, it was like the original NASCAR to watch chariots race around the corners and crash, and the crowds just can't get enough of it. If you get tired of the Colosseum and the Hippodrome, there's theater after theater after theater all across town. Entertainment was everywhere. Maybe it's the reason why they say all roads lead to Rome. And I'm not sure, but my bet is when he had a chance, that's why he ventured there. With his skill set, sure, he could probably find a job pretty easy, but there's one problem. He's illegal. He doesn't have papers. He's not a citizen of Rome. And when you live on the streets, word spreads quickly on who's generous and who to avoid. And we have no idea how these two particular people come in contact with each other. Did he just hear a name and was like, oh, he recognized it from his own land? We don't know. Did he seek him out? Or was he a fugitive hanging around with other fugitives and he just heard the words? We don't know how these two got together. But it's one of the most unlikely stories in the entire Bible. It's one page. No chapters, just verses. We have the book of Philemon, and it's in the New Testament. And as you're trying to flip it and find it, let me kind of give you some of the backstory just to kind of catch you up. You see, rumors have spread from a man from Jerusalem, you know, one who walks on water, one who feeds 5,000 out of a G.I. Joe lunchbox, and yet there's still leftovers. You know, one who teaches in a way that grown men will leave their trade just to follow him. One who's going to, you know, spit on a guy's eyes who's blind and now he can see. One who's going to touch those with oozing pus and sores of leprosy. And all of a sudden, molecules are rearranged and skin is made new. One who the Roman government tried to kill, and yet he rose from the dead. And as these rumors spread, there's a guy named Paul carrying that news to the known world. And he can keep your attention. You see, Paul used to kill and torture Christians. He had the backing of the government to stomp out the message of Christianity until one day the risen Christ met Paul on the road and said, "Why are you persecuting me, Paul?" And Paul didn't have an answer. And 3 years of connecting the dots and putting pieces together, Paul realizes Jesus is the Son of God. Now Paul travels all across the Roman Empire, planting church after church after church. He would simply say, "You've heard rumors about this Jesus. Let me tell you who he is and why he came." And he did this until one day the Roman government decided, "We've had enough of you, Paul. You can't teach that there's only one God. Caesar is God." And to shut Paul up, they put him in prison in Rome. But they put him under house arrest, which means people can come and go, but he's not allowed to leave. People come and take care of you. It's the way Rome kind of dealt with long-term prisoners. Why should Rome feed and clothe you? We're going to put them under house arrest and leave it to others to feed and clothe them. And yet Paul, under house arrest, keeps on writing to the churches he planted. To the church in Ephesus, he writes the book Ephesians. To the church in Philippi, he writes Philippians. To the church in Corinth, he writes 1 and 2 Corinthians. He keeps writing letters back that make up over half of our New Testament, or nearly half of our New Testament. And one of the churches he planted was in Colossae. And there was a home church started by Paul. And we have a guy named Onesimus who broke away and ran away from his master. He was a slave. And he made his way for free bread and free entertainment in Rome. And while in Rome, this fugitive met a church planter from the city he was from, and they met up in Rome. And we don't know how. And after a while of hanging around with Paul, Paul tells this guy, "You need to go back home." And to help him out, Paul's actually going to write him a kind of get out of jail free card to his owner, Philemon. It's one of the most unlikely stories in the entire Bible, but yet one of the most powerful examples for you and for me today. All right, now I've given you about 5 to 7 minutes to find Philemon in your Bible. If you're still having trouble, it's in the New Testament, okay? So open it up, go towards the back of your Bible, pass all of the T's, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Timothy, Titus, stop. You've got Philemon. If you hit Hebrews, a kind of big book, you went too far, back it up to the left. Remember, small book, one page, no chapters, just verses. And as I was studying, I really wanted to teach throughout the book of Philemon. So this is going to be more of like a running commentary as we go through. There's all different kinds of points and themes, and I want to point them out to you because I think this whole book applies to you and to me today. So go ahead and open it up, and I'll say chapter one, but that's the only number of chapters that's there. And here we go. Verse one, Philemon, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker, also to Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Circle, highlight, underline. They've got a life group, or their C groups are meeting together in their homes. I mean, they had a house church, because we have to understand, up until about 300 AD, the church couldn't even own property. The church started in people's homes. And so we have this, you know, leader, his name's Philemon. He's kind of the church leader in this home. They're meeting together. We don't know for sure, but we are pretty sure that Apphia is his wife and Archippus is his son. We're not 100% sure, but we, you know, most scholars think that. So this is a personal letter. Most of Paul's letters are to areas, to churches, not this one. This is for one specific person. This is going to hit an area of slavery, which is very delicate to say the least. And in the Roman household, the wife would have kind of charge of those who worked in the home. So it includes her. And since this is, talks about, you know, his family and his wealth and his property, he includes his son. So here we go. He says, it's me, Paul. I'm a prisoner of Christ Jesus. And this isn't the main point of the book, but or the, of this letter, but isn't that interesting how he says that? He says, I'm a prisoner of Christ Jesus. Paul doesn't say I'm a prisoner of Rome. He doesn't say I'm a prisoner of Caesar. You know, I'm a victim of bad legal rights. He doesn't say that. You know, do you check this out? Paul takes his earthly place, what's happening to him right now, and he puts a heavenly spin on it. This helps him deal with where he is in life. You know, if you want to take notes, write it down this way. Our position in heaven should always trump our place in life. You know, if you're a Christ follower, you're a son or daughter of Jesus, you're heir to the throne. That is eternal. That should always trump where you and I are in life. And I get it. Some of you are probably like, Steve, you don't get it. I'm stuck in this dead-end job with a boss who is an idiot. Look, I get that. I've been there. I mean, not right now. Jeff's awesome, right? But not right now. But I've had bosses that are like that. You're just like, oh, this guy I'm working for, this woman, she is just an idiot. I don't know how to do this. So here's what you do. Every day you wake up and say, I, an employee of Christ Jesus. That changes everything. Some of you might be like, well, let's see. Okay, that's cool. That's kind of cute. But you know what? My marriage is horrible. It's unfruitful. It's unloving. Okay, so for you, you wake up every day and you say, I, a spouse of Christ Jesus. I just wonder how you and I would treat things differently if we take what our temporary place is in life right now and let our position in heaven override our position on earth. If we see this where we are right now and we're figuring, okay, we can't really get out of this, how can I play my role? And how can I do this faithfully for Jesus? You see, in this one-page letter, Paul refers to himself three different times as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. It's not just great theology. It's a great way to spend your days. You see, Paul could sit in that home and think about all day what he could be doing, where he could be, what these guys have done to him. Oh, he's going against the Roman Empire, and he would just get bitter. He would never get better. But you see what Paul does? He sees his heavenly position over his earthly position. And he's like, what role do I need to play here? What role do I play here for Christ? And it changes everything. And as he continues to write to Philemon, verse 4, he says, I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your love for all of his holy people and for your faith in the Lord Jesus. I pray that your partnership with us in the faith may be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing we share for the sake of Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the Lord's people. Come on, just quick second. Let's kind of get our minds wrapped around what's happening here. This is amazing, right? Here's Paul, and he's writing a personal letter to Philemon. We don't have a whole lot of these. He normally writes to areas and to churches. This one's specific for one person. He's like, look, I've been encouraged by you. I've heard about your home. I've heard about your life group, your C groups that are meeting together, and I've heard all about your love for people. I've heard about your love for God's people, and I am encouraged about how you're loving Christ and loving others. And he's just kind of building them up. He's like, look, I pray that you may be active in your faith so you can have a better understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. You see, in other words, we can write it down this way. Not sharing our faith may mean missing out on God's plan and our purpose. You see, when you share your faith with others, you will walk in the fullness of everything God has for you. If we don't do that, if we don't share our faith, we are missing out on God's plan and his purpose. Christianity has never been a solo sport. You know, it's never been about accepting Christ and getting into heaven. You know, that's part one, but there's two parts of Christianity. See, part two is share that. Be a light. Be a witness. Be salt. Be flavor. Be love in someone's life. What God has allowed you and me to partake in, share that. That's what Paul's saying. He's saying, Philemon, I'm praying you're sharing your faith so that you may walk in the fullness of God's plan. To do that, we need to be sharing. We need to be active in our faith. It's why we're still here. It's to know Christ and then to share that. He's like, Philemon, I've heard great stuff about your life group, your C groups meeting together in your home. I've heard great stuff about that. You're doing great things. I pray you continue to share all that stuff so you can have the fulfillment of what God wants for you. And then here it goes. You almost know something's coming, right? It's one of the best drive-by guiltings in history. Verse 8. Therefore, although in Christ I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I prefer to appeal to you out of the basis of love. This is great, right? I mean, all of a sudden he's like, hey, you almost knew something was coming. Here's all this stuff. Philemon, you're great. You're great. I love how you're loving people. You know what? I could order you to do something, but instead I'm just going to ask. I mean, this is a pretty powerful card he's playing. As parents, we understand this. We can be like, look, kids, we can ground you for life if you don't clean your room, or I'm just going to ask you to. I mean, that's what Paul's saying. I could order you to do this, but I'm just going to ask you out of love. You know, and he says that in verse 9. I prefer to appeal to you on the basis of love. It is as none other than Paul, an old man, and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I mean, this just gets really, really good here. He's like, look, I could order you, but I'm not going to. I'm just going to ask you out of love, which, by the way, I could order you because I'm the one who kind of planted this church. So I'm just going to ask you, which, by the way, I'm really, really old and a prisoner. So I'm just going to ask a favor, right? I mean, this is getting great. And look what he says. And I just wonder how this hits Philemon. He says, I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus. Oh. Hold on. This is the dude who ran away from Philemon. Onesimus, I just wonder how this hit him. The kid who ran away on me, who robbed me. And look, we don't know why Onesimus ran off on Philemon. We don't know. But now he's appealing to Philemon on behalf of Onesimus. And look what happens. Verse 10. Who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now has become useful both to you and to me. Now, there's a little bit of comedy here. There's a little bit of a wordplay going on. He says, and I even wonder if Philemon kind of chuckled at this a little bit because he's like, look, your slave was once useless to you, but now I found him useful. Okay, maybe you didn't get it either because you don't understand maybe what Onesimus means. Onesimus, his name actually means useful. And three times here, Paul uses that. He says, look, once he wasn't useful to you, now he is useful to me and to you. In other words, he didn't live up to his name before, but now he is living up to his name. In fact, he says, look, I met him in prison. I discipled him. He's become a son to me, which means he's in the family. He has now accepted Christ as his savior. He's like, now he knows his identity. He knows and understands his potential. And he's like, I get this. This is going to be a tough ask. But verse 12, I'm sending him who is my very heart back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I'm in chains for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent so that any favor you would do would not seem forced, but be voluntary. Perhaps the reason he was separated you for a little while was that you might have him back forever. Look at this. No longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a fellow man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. And we hit this this word slave that is really, really tough and delicate. And we have to understand, please understand this. What Scripture is talking about here is nothing like the horrific evil of the first few centuries at the beginning of our country of slavery. You see, early historians estimate that roughly half of the citizens of Rome, or the civilians in Rome, about 60 million of them were slaves, right? And it's very different from slavery in our country when it started. And it was that horrific evil that plagued the early years of our country, where people were simply kidnapped because of their color of their skin and treated as non-equals, treated less than human. This text is not the same thing here when it's talking about slaves and slavery. You know, if you weren't a citizen of Rome, you were considered a slave. Some people could buy their Roman citizenship, but not everybody. They were the same color. You know, you could be a foreigner and be free in Rome as long as you had papers to prove it. You know, but if you didn't, everybody else was considered a slave. Some of the most highly educated, highly paid workers in the Roman Empire were slaves. Doctors, lawyers, accountants, professors, you know, they were still called slaves because they didn't have Roman citizenship. Now, we have to understand, slavery back then, what they're talking about here, is almost a payment. You owe something. So think about it this way. You have a Visa credit card, probably a lot of us do, and you've ran up the bill on that pretty good, and you are what? You are in debt to Visa. So Visa could come to you and be like, all right, look, we know you can't pay it off. We know you can't pay your debt out. So you just come work for Visa and pay off your debt. All right. So they're not enslaving people. They're just simply saying, look, you've racked up a debt. You can work to pay off your debt. Completely different from what we've experienced in our country the first 100 years. So here's a guy, and we don't know the whole story. Somewhere Onesimus ran away from Philemon. All right. And Paul disciples him. He comes to know Jesus. He's like, Paul, he asks him, all right, dude, you got to go home. I'll write you a letter to help get you back there. And this is so cool. Onesimus, who was a fugitive because he ran away because without paying off his debt, he completely ran away. And now he kind of sits under Paul. Paul disciples him. And now he's actually going to deliver, he's going to help deliver the letter of Colossians to the church in Colossae. I mean, it's powerful, right? And then he's like, and here's one more letter for you. And this is for Philemon. So he goes back to who he ran away from. And he's like, here you go. And when Philemon writes this, opens this up, Paul's writing to him. And he was like, Philemon, I need you to make this right. And it continues in verse 18. If he has done you wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will pay it back. Not to mention, you owe me your very life. I do wish, brother, that I may have some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I ask. And one more thing. Prepare a guest room for me, because I hope to be restored to you in answer to your prayer. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, send you greetings, and so do Mark, Articus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. And the grace, circle, highlight, underline, of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Now, I don't know if you caught it, but this small letter starts and ends, it bookends with this thing about grace. In verse 3, at the beginning of this chapter, it says, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. This whole thing is about grace. And Paul's saying, look, we've got an issue here. I know what culture says you're allowed to do, Philemon, because he ran away. All right. I know what the law says you're allowed to do, but I'm writing to you as a leader of the church that meets in your home. You start practicing your Christianity. And it's going to come in an area where you have been wronged. It's going to come in an area where you have the right to react in any way you want. But because of who you are, and more importantly, because of whose you are, I'm going to encourage you to live this out differently. If you want to write this out, here's, you know, one of the truths from this text. When we do wrong, we need to make it right. And when we've been wronged, we need to let it go. Let me say it again. When we've done something wrong, we need to make it right. And when we've been wrong, we need to let it go. And in fact, Paul's talking to both of these guys here. He's like, look, dude, you ran away from a debt you need to pay. You need to make this right. And Philemon, remember, this isn't, and please hear me, this isn't saying where it talks about slavery in our country was like, oh, they should have went back to their masters. No, completely different. They didn't have a debt to pay off. Those people were kidnapped into slavery. It was brutal and evil. Completely different here. Onesimus had a debt to pay off to Philemon, and he ran away without paying it. And Paul's like, you got to make that right. When we do something wrong, we need to make it right. And then he's saying to Philemon, hey, you've been wronged, and I need you to let it go. And Paul's picking up on something that Jesus taught, is that the moment you and I became a Christian, that we became a follower of Jesus, you and I might have the right culturally and legally to respond one way, but because you and I are Christians and we are followers of Jesus, we need to choose to react differently. You see, Paul doesn't want Philemon to sit in his living room, discuss theology and know the Bible and all that and have all this right stuff in your head about scripture. Paul's caring more about how he's living this out. He cares more about how you and I are living out our lives as Christ followers. Is Christianity just going to be your title, I'm a Christian? Or is it going to be your testimony on how we live it out? He's like, Onesimus, Philemon, I'm asking both of you to come back together to do this. It's going to take a lot from both of you, right? I know you've been wronged, Philemon. And if he owes you anything, I love this. If he owes you anything, if he stole from you, charge it to me. I'll pay for it. Paul's like, I will take the debt that Onesimus owes you. If he, give it to me, write it off to me. By the way, you owe me your life. I love that line, right? And I think Jesus does this for us too, right? Paul's saying, Philemon, look. I'll pay back whatever it is he owes you. I just want to remind you, you owe me your life. And he reminds Philemon where he once was. He's reminding you and reminding me where we once were before we accepted Christ and Christ paying our debt on the cross that we could never have paid back. He's like, let me remind you the grace that's been given to you. And if you want to go a little deeper in Matthew, Jesus hits on this, and it's what Paul's picking up on. Jesus talks about this all through the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But if you go in Matthew, we're going to hit a couple of quick things in Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 6, and Matthew chapter 18. You can turn there if you want, or we'll probably put up on the screen for you, or you can just look it up later. But Jesus is teaching on how Christians, you know, how we should understand what God has given you, what he's given me, and that we need to pass these on to others, which is forgiveness, grace, and mercy. Jesus is teaching, look, people have wronged you. People have wronged me. There are people who seriously probably owe you something. There are people who owe me something. And Jesus simply says, I know. But here's what you signed up for. You see, in Matthew 5, Jesus is talking about if you're bringing something to the altar, you know, as a gift to God in the temple, if you're going to do that, and you remember that another follower of Christ has something against you, leave your gift right there, go make it right with that person, and then come back. That's how serious this is. And I know maybe we don't understand temple and altar, but let me kind of put it this way. Don't stand up and worship and praise God if you know somebody, another Christ follower, has something against you. He was like, look, don't try and worship me if it's not good with his children. Go make that right, and then you can come back and we can worship together, right? But don't say, oh yeah, God, I love you, I praise you, I want to worship you, and you know that there is another believer who's got something against you. He's like, no, it doesn't work that way. You need to clear that up before you come back to worship. And it may sound extreme, but once you've been a parent of more than one child, you get this, right? I mean, I've got two beautiful daughters, And look, there have been plenty of times we've been driving home and there's fighting in the back seat and they're kicking and screaming, she scratched me off, she took my book, and she called me a stupid head. And they're just going after each other. Maybe it's just my kids, right? But I mean, they're just going at each other. And then all of a sudden, you know, they're like, hey, daddy, can we stop for Mr. Softy? What? No? Are you kidding me? I mean, you two were just fighting with each other. You stole, you hit, you called her a stupid head. Why'd you do that? Well, that's because she was a stupid head. It's just like, no, don't be fighting with each other and then ask me for ice cream. You have lost your mind. I mean, if the two of them would learn to get along, I'd buy a Mr. Softy every single day. Maybe they won't watch that part, right? But I mean, but as a dad, as parents, we get that. That's what God is trying to say. He was like, don't try and worship me. Don't try and worship your heavenly Father, knowing there's other people in the family that have something against you. Go clear that up. And then come back and we can talk about ice cream. God doesn't want us worshiping him if we're fighting against each other. And then in chapter 6 of Matthew, the disciples ask Jesus, hey, how should we pray? And you may have heard that prayer, the Lord's Prayer. And we get to that one part in the middle where it says, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. Maybe that's why we don't like to say that prayer, right? In other words, forgive us our debts as we've also forgiven our debtors. Yeah, and I love this. In verse 14 of chapter 6, Jesus says, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive each other's sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Say what? Jesus is joking, right? I mean, that's really not what Jesus said. You know, hold on. It's like, we want to believe Jesus died on the cross, so I'm forgiven. That's what forgive my sins. There's not like a clause in there somewhere, is there? And Jesus says, look, here's how I want you to pray every day. God, forgive my sins just like I've forgiven everybody else's sins. If you can't forgive other people's sins, then you can't be forgiven by God. I mean, and some of us are like, well, that's not what they told us in Sunday school, right? And yet Jesus makes it pretty clear. And he goes on in Matthew chapter 18, and he tells this story, and this is so powerful. Verse 21 of chapter 18, Peter comes to Jesus and asks, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? Because I love what Paul's doing, or I love what Peter's doing here, because you know, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, they taught you have to forgive 3 times. So Peter's like, well, I'll double that and add one, make it 7. That is going to make me look really good. So do I need to forgive 7 times? And Jesus answers, I tell you not 7 times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of God is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay the master what the master ordered, he and his wife and his children and all that he had was to be sold to repay the debt. And verse 26, at this the servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. This is about, you know, almost a third of the wages of a year's salary. I mean, he owed him a lot. And this guy who just had all of his debt canceled, he grabs this guy and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. And his fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me, I'll pay it back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay off the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went to their master and told everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said. I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have shown mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had on you? And in his anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he could pay back all that he owed. Verse 35, this is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. Amen. It's like the worst story in history, right? I mean, seriously, that's in red letters? Come on, let's be real. You and me, or maybe just you, between you and God. There's people in life that have wronged you, aren't there? There's people in life that have wronged me. There's people in life that owe you and owe me. There are people in life that have literally hurt you. And Jesus is telling them, just as he was telling us, look, don't worship if another brother or sister in Christ has something against you. Clear that up. Then we can worship. Then we can have that time together and growing together. In fact, here's how I want you to pray. God, forgive me as I have forgiven. Who is it for you? Put their name in there. God, forgive my sins the way I've forgiven my ex. God, will you forgive my sins the way I've forgiven my former business partner? Forgive me the way I've forgiven my boss, the way I've forgiven my child, the way I've forgiven my dad or my mom. We should add that to our prayers. Because Jesus said the same way you and I forgive others is the same way our Heavenly Father will forgive you and forgive me. I mean, he flat out says it in verse 35. He says, this is how my Heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or your sister from your heart. And Paul sits in prison roughly 30 years later with a runaway fugitive and a man who deserves to be repaid and a culture that says you have every right to do whatever you want to this guy. And Paul separates culture from Christianity. He says, I could order you to do this, but instead, I'm just going to ask. And let me remind you of who you were and what's been given to you, because I am confident of that. I'm pretty sure you're going to go above and beyond even what I'm asking, that you won't consider this guy a slave anymore. He will be your brother. There's family. There is now a connection through Christ. I'm believing you will do that and even more, which, by the way, I want you to prepare a room for me because I want to stop by and just check it out, see how you're doing. A couple of things just to kind of take home from this story. You see, true Christianity will be seen in how we love those who have wronged us and those who are different than us. Truly loving others only happens when you and I remember that we deserve the death penalty. We had a debt called sin that we could not repay. And we needed a mediator. And Jesus came and took death on a cross for you and for me. Because you and I, we needed our debt paid. It's no chapters, just verses. And yet such an unlikely story, but yet so powerful for you and for me. The book of Philemon. Because God is more concerned about reconciliation than he is revenge. And right now, I just want to lead you in a prayer. If you're out there, you're watching this, and you have never accepted Christ as your Savior, your Heavenly Father wants you to know he loves you so much that you have a debt because you've sinned. And he loves you so much, he sent his Son to this earth. His name was Jesus. He lived a perfect life, had never sinned, and he took death on a cross to pay for your debt, to pay for your sin debt, because he wants reconciliation between you and the God who created you. And I'm just going to lead you in a prayer, and you can either say the same words as me, or you can just say it in your own words, in your own heart, to accept what you and I don't deserve, but accepting Jesus as your Savior so that our debt can be forgiven and paid, and we now understand what God has given us, and now we share that with others. So if that's you and you want to take that step today, just close your eyes and just say, Heavenly Father, God, thank you so much for putting me in front of this screen today. Thank you for allowing me to see this and to hear your words. God, I really don't know what words to say. I'm sorry. There's been a lot of junk and a lot of sin in my life. It's a debt I know I can't repay to you. God, I thank you for sending your son to die for me. Thank you that his death on a cross covered my sins and paid for my debt so I can now have relationship with you. God, I thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, that now I ask that you would just fill me with your Holy Spirit. Help me to learn and understand how much you love me, so in return, I can show others how you love them. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for loving me. And please give me the wisdom to know what to do and the courage to do it. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you said that prayer, I just want you to know heaven is going crazy right now for you. In fact, we want you to let us know if you said that prayer. Because if you said that prayer, today is your day. Click in the little description and click on the link that says today is my day and let us know, because we want to celebrate with you. Because God, he is all about love and reconciliation, not revenge. He loves you so much. So please let us know, either in the comment box, click the form and let us know. But we want to celebrate with you, because God is all about reconciliation. It's not revenge. It's the book of Philemon. It's a book of love and of how, as Christ followers, we go above and beyond what culture and laws say we should or shouldn't do. And right now, we're just going to go into a time of worship through song. And I just pray whatever God is stirring in you to do, for you and for me, that he would give us the courage to know what to do and to step out and be able to do it.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to my heart, will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. Still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my God. great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. The promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me. Failed me yet, and I never will forget. You've never failed me yet, and I never will forget.
Christ United, once again, thank you so much for watching. And if you enjoyed today's service, be sure to like the video. What is liking, you ask? Well, me and Casey were actually just talking about it. It's when you share and you like a video. So be sure to do that. Hey, thank you so much for giving today as well. It means a whole lot to us here at Christ United. Don't forget, every Wednesday at 7 p.m. is Discipleship Live. You can jump on Zoom and join the folks there, or you can simply get on Facebook Live and you can check it out there. Don't forget, one more time, y'all, we're going to the Blessed Barn in Aynor on July 12th at 10 a.m. Remember, you have to register. That's why we're telling you again, okay? ChristIsLove.org, register. We'll see you at the Blessed Barn. Thanks for watching.